الله أكبر 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 لا إله إلا الله والله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ألا كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته فالأمير الذي على الناس راع وهو مسؤول عن رعيته والرجل راع على أهل بيته وهو مسؤول عنهم إلى آخر الحديث صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has made us witness this day of Yawm al-Adha, a day of celebration for the Muslims, a day of sacrifice, a day of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَلِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ جَعَلْنَا مَنْسَكًا لِيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ فَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ فَلَهُ أَسْلِمُوا وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ. And for every nation, we have made rituals so that they may remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon what He has sustained them from livestock animals. So your Lord is one Lord, so submit to Him, and glad tidings be to the humble ones. We send blessings and salutations upon our beloved master and leader, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and whoever follows their path until the day of Qiyamah. On this special day of Eid, we send our congratulations to the Hujjaj who have undertaken the journey of Hajj to fulfill one of the pillars of Islam. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts all of their good deeds, whether it be their tawaf, whether it be their sa'i, whether it be their sacrificing of the animals, whether it be pelting of the jamarat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it all from them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the opportunity to repeatedly go and visit His house and fulfill this great ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When one ponders over the rituals of Hajj, when one ponders over the symbols of Islam that are found in Mecca, we remember our father Ibrahim alayhi salam and his journey of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in submission and sacrifice for him. Indeed, Ibrahim alayhi salam has left us with a legacy and he has left us with teachings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us regarding Ibrahim alayhi salam, Inna Ibrahim kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifa walam yaku min al-mushrikeen. Indeed, Ibrahim was an ummah himself, he was a nation himself, obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pure, and he was not from those who ascribe partners to Allah. Shakiran li an'umih, he was grateful for his favors. Ijtabahu wa hadahu ila siratin mustaqim, Allah had guided him to the straight path, he had chosen him and guided him to the straight path. From amongst the teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam is a dua, a very famous dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, wherein Ibrahim alayhi salam had said, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَا, that, O my Lord, make me from those who establish salah, as well as from my progeny. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ, O my Lord, forgive me, O our Lord, forgive me, and my parents, and the believers on the day of reckoning. I would like to take four lessons from this dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. That is the aspect of salah, the aspect of our children, the aspect of our parents, and as an ummah, the believers. If we look at the first aspect of this dua, Ibrahim alayhi salam makes the dua for the establishment of salah. That, oh Allah, make me from those who establish salah. Establishment of salah is not merely coming and reading salah to get done with the duty, but rather establishment of salah is fulfilling all of those aspects which perfect our salah, whether it be our salah on time, whether it be correctly performing it according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or whether it be doing it with our correct devotion and humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. That salah is prescribed upon the believers at specific times. So let us all renew our intention that we will perform salah on time. Not that we will read salah delayed. At the end of the day, we will read qada of every salah. No. Salah has to be performed at every time when it is prescribed. Another aspect is that we should read salah according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Perform salah as you have seen me perform salah. One of the great aspects of this ummah is that Allah has preserved our deen. Unlike the Jews and the Christians who have lost their deen, we have a preserved deen from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have a method of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should ask our ulama, we should attend classes so that we perform salah the way that it is supposed to be performed. Another aspect of our salah is Allah tells us, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Certainly the believers have succeeded, those who in their salah they are humbled. When we perform salah, we are coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with humility. We are putting our head on the ground before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if our salah is performed correctly, then we will reap the benefits of the salah. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Certainly, salah prevents a person from immorality and evil. If we perform our salah correctly, then undoubtedly we will see this benefit and our life will come in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah grant us the ability to establish salah, especially us as men, as we have gathered here today on the Eid al-Adha in jama'ah. Let us make this intention that every salah, we will read it in jama'ah, we will read it in the masjid, so that we be from those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like the malaika do. Ibrahim alayhi salam thereafter includes in his dua his progeny. He says, وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي, as well as from my progeny, that my progeny too should be from those who are successful, those who read salah. And Ibrahim alayhi salam did not forget about his children's akhirah. This has to be our concern as parents. As parents, we have an amana, we have a trust, we have a responsibility to our children. In the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us, that Allah wa kullukum ra'in, each one of you is a shepherd. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam goes on to mention about a father. He is a shepherd over his home. That it is our responsibility to take care of our children, to nurture our children, to grow them up according to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How often is it not that we hear the complaint, children are disrespectful, children are going off the track, children are not worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and are not obedient in their life. The question we should ask ourselves as parents, are we fulfilling our responsibility to our children? Are we giving them the correct upbringing? Or are we leaving them to become victims of the shaitan and the society that is they are living in? I would like to mention a few aspects that parents should just remember regarding upbringing of their parents. There are many things that can be mentioned, but just to highlight a few aspects. The first aspect is spend time with our children. Look after them. Because if we do not spend time with them, they will find other friends. They will find other influences in their life. Let us create a strong bond with their deen from the home, so that they learn good values. They learn the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they love for the deen of Allah.
Because we know in the hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, الرجل على دين خليله فلينظر أحدكم بمن يخالل. A person is upon the religion of his friends, so beware of who you befriend. And if these children befriend those that are going to take them to the disobedience of Allah, those that won't even remind them of salah, those that will introduce them maybe to drugs and all sorts of haram, then this will be the route that they live. So as parents, let us take our children in, let us nurture them personally. Secondly, the education of our children. This is a very important aspect. Education of our children is primarily education of the Quran, education of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our children are going to live an entire life. They are going through a phase where they have all of the fitnas in front of them. They have to go to adulthood and they have to face all of the challenges that will come with adulthood. Remember, education does not stop when a child is 16 years old. What he has learned in madrasa, in maktab, this is not sufficient. In actual fact, knowledge is something that has to be from the cradle to the grave, as it is said. And the way to achieve this is that we as adults should also be involved in ta'aleem, learning and teaching of the Quran. It does not make sense that we insist on our children to learn the deen of Allah, but we ourselves, we are not learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have no excuse. If we just look into our town, there are many madrasas, there are many masajid, they have adult classes. There are circles in the masjid that are conducted. Let us make a time that we can sit with ulama and we can learn the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because education and learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what is going to protect us from the challenges that are out there in this world. How much don't we sacrifice for education of the dunya? How much don't we sacrifice to give them the best of the world? But in reality, the best sacrifice we can do is to give them the deen of Allah so that they grow up with a strong connection and a strong bond and a strong love for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala long after we are gone. Another important aspect regarding our children is for us to beware of electronic devices and the access to the internet that they have. Unfortunately, we live in a time where people feel it is a necessity, where people feel that my child needs to have a device in their hand so that they can live nicely. But if this is going to ruin them, this is going to destroy their akhirah, then there is no good in it. Remember that when the child has that phone in front of them, all of the child has this device in their hand, all of the shayateen of the world, the worst of people, the actors, the musicians, the influencers, the athletes, all of these people whose day and night is filled with khamar, with alcohol and zina, these are the people that are influencing our children. Don't for a moment feel guilty. If you do not give your child a device, do not feel guilty. This is for the protection of the akhirah. When they are ready for it, then we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them the tawfiq and gives us the tawfiq to use it correctly. Unfortunately, it is sad to say, but we are aware of at times where children as young as 8 and 9 years old are sitting in the toilets of their schools, or na'udhu billah, even in the masjid, and they are addicted to pornography. When this is a challenge for the adults of the ummah, how do we think that the children are free from it and are not going to be attracted by it? These are a few aspects. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to protect our children and give our children the ability to grow up with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to constantly make dua for this. When a person turns and makes dua with sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all hearing and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all merciful. The dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam continues, رَبَّنَا غْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. Ibrahim alayhi salam asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for mercy and forgiveness for himself and his parents and for the believers on the day of Hisab. Regarding the parents, as parents we have a duty to our children, and more so as children we have duties to our parents. It does not matter if we are 15 years old or we are 50 years old. Our parents will always be our parents. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And do not say to them, uff, and do not shun them, and say to them a noble word. This is the etiquette of Islam. This is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us to treat our parents. It does not mean that they are old. It does not mean that they are, maybe they have lost their minds in a little way. It does not mean that they are slow, that we can treat them the way we want to. But rather it is our duty. It is from the Akbarul Kabair. It is from amongst the most major sins in Islam that a person is disrespectful to his parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to fulfill our rights to our parents. Indeed, if we spend our entire life in their khidmah and in their service, we will never be able to fulfill this duty. So it is our responsibility to care for them, to honor them. And when they are alive and when they have passed on, we make dua for them. The dua that Allah teaches us in the Quran, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا, that, oh my Lord, have mercy upon them as they had mercy upon me when I was young. Ibrahim alayhi salam then makes dua for the ummah, وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ, and for the believers on the day of reckoning. As Muslims, we have an identity. An identity of people that started from the time of Adam alayhi salam for as long as the world will carry on with believers. In the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about certain anbiya, Allah mentions a host of anbiya. Thereafter Allah mentions, Inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahida wa ana rabbukum, Inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahidatan wa ana rabbukum fa'budun, that certainly this is your ummah, one ummah, and I am your Lord, so worship me. This is our identity. We are believers. And on top of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made us specifically from the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the khayrul umam, the best of nations, regarding which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us, نحن الآخرون السابقون يوم القيامة. We are the last in this world, but we will be the first on the day of Qiyamah. Indeed, being part of this ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a great virtue. But with every virtue, there comes a responsibility. If we do not fulfill the rights of being the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by upholding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will lose this virtue. Let us remember the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that on the day of Qiyamah, when he will be with his hawd al-kawthar, his pond, when he will be giving his ummah water to drink, he will recognize people of his ummah that will be there waiting. But the malaika will come and take these people away. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, innahum minni, they are part of my people, they are part of my nation. But the malaika will reply to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that innaka la tadri ma ahdathu ba'dak. You do not know what they had introduced after you. You don't know what they had done after you, what they had changed after you. And unfortunately, how sad it will be, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's reply will be, suhqan suhqa, get away, get away. Do we want to be from those who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will turn us away on the day of Qiyamah? Never. Our responsibility is to fulfill the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As an ummah, we should remember that there are many fitan, there are many trials and there are many tests that we are facing. And it is our duty and responsibility to hold firm to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of these fitnas, just to highlight a few of them, that we as Muslims need to be careful and not fall into and guard against. The first aspect is the disease of selective Islam, where we pick and we choose what we like of Islam and we turn and we reject what we don't like. Allah warns us in the Quran, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Do you believe in part of the book and you disbelieve in a part of the book? This is not the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are supposed to follow. Our deen is a complete deen. If a person becomes selective and he wants to tailor make his deen according to his whims and fancies, then he will be guilty on the day of Qiyamah. And as Allah continues in the ayah, فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ, that there will be no reward for that person except that he will have humiliation in this worldly life, and on the day of Qiyamah he will be returned to the worst of punishments. Allah tells us in the Quran, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Perhaps you dislike something, but it is good for you. And perhaps you dislike, and perhaps you like, you dislike something, and it is bad for you. And Allah knows, and you do not know. Let us trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is alim, Allah is hakim, Allah is all knowing, Allah is all wise. Let us trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decisions in how He has legislated His deen for us. Let us not become selective and pick and choose, we like this and we don't like this. Whatever Allah has given us, we follow to the best of our abilities. Another fitna that we face as an ummah is where the enemies of Islam try to desensitize us regarding our deen and thereby try to extinguish the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find that they will insult our deen. They will insult our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They will spill our blood. They will do things to try and diminish the important teachings of Islam. As Muslims, we should never tolerate this. We should never tolerate the attacks against our deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent us with a responsibility to uplift, to promote, to defend and to fight for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can marvel at different leaders of the world and freedom fighters, but we have the best of examples in front of us. We have Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have Umar ibn al-Khattab. We have Ali ibn Abi Talib. We have Khalid ibn Walid radiyallahu anhu. These are our heroes of Islam. And we should look at their lives and take guidance from their lives and follow and protect the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it means it will cost us our lives. Another fitna and another challenge we face as Muslims is this obsession with the dunya, this obsession with the world and all of the glitter and the glamour that is in the world. We find that we live in a time where materialism has been glorified. Materialism has become the order of the day. That a person will do whatever he can just to gain a few pennies and pounds. A person will do whatever he can just to earn the world and to enjoy the world. We find that the aspect of riba, of consuming and using and going towards interest, has become the order of the day in most people. Whether it be the wealthy through banks, whether it be the poor through personal loans, people are involved in riba day in and day out. How can this be when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares war, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, that beware of a war from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on those who do riba. And this is none other or no other reason besides our greed for this world that will push us in this direction. So let us not be obsessed of the dunya. The dunya is a prison for the believer and it is the jannah for the kafir. Don't look at what the disbelievers have and think that we should be following their ways. Allah warns us in the Quran, لا يغرنك تقلب الذين كفروا في البلاد متاع قليل ثم مأواهم جهنم وبئس المهاد. That let not the movement of the disbelievers in the land amaze you and deceive you. It is a small enjoyment, and their abode is Jahannam, and what an evil abode. So let us not be attracted by the dunya that the kuffar have. We have a better goal, and that is the goal of the akhirah through the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another aspect is, as Muslim, we should be cautious of different types of movements that are moving around in this earth, and all inviting to the ways of shaitan. A simple example, the LGBTQ group, those that invite to the people, the actions of the people of Lut alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had destroyed the nation for what they were doing. And unfortunately, we find in our times that there are huge movements, and to the extent that it has now affected the Muslims, where they start justifying it, start calling to it and inviting to it, and calling for tolerance towards it. This is not our way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions over and over in the Quran regarding these people, and we should protect our iman. Indeed, any person who regards something which Allah has regarded as haram to be halal, then that person is out of the fold of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all of these type of movements. Another aspect is our love for the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Let us not be deceived by people who claim and the slogans of unity. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Regarding our love for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, as Muslims, our love for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum is taken from our deen. It is in the Quran. We love Ali radiallahu anhu. the cousin and the son-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We regard Fatima al-Zahra, the Sayyidatu Nisa'i Ahlul Jannah, the queen of the women of Jannah. And in a similar way, we accept and we love the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the last few days of his life, he had chosen Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu to be the Imam of the Muslims. So our love for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum should always be there. In conclusion, remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, that hold firm to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together, and do not disperse, do not fragment, do not separate. Let us stand as an ummah together. We should be wary of two extremes in this regard. Number one is where we make takfir and we take people out of the fold of Islam without any valid reason. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the Messenger of Allah sallam warns us in a hadith, man qala li akhihi ya adu wallahi aw ya kafir faqad ba'a bihi ahaduhuma. Whoever says to his brother Muslim that, O enemy of Allah, O kafir, so one of them returns with it. On the other hand, we have the opposite extreme, where people include and they welcome and they bring into Islam those who are not from Islam, where they will bring foreign ideologies into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah had warned Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, Ya ayyuhan nabiyu attaqillaha wa la tuti'il kafirina wal munafiqeen. O nabi, fear Allah and do not obey the disbelievers and the hypocrites. So let us be wary of this and let us hold to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remember the words of Allah, وَلَن تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَن نَصَارَ حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ, that the Jews and the Christians will never be happy with you until you follow their way. In conclusion, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us through iman and faith and subservience to Him. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants shifa to all of those who are ill. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon those who have passed away from our near and dear ones. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assists the mujahideen and all of those who are struggling to establish the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the four corners of the earth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless and reward those who are inviting to his deen, who are spreading his deen and who are teaching the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah alleviate the suffering of the ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for those who are going through financial difficulties. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant pious and righteous spouses and offspring to those who are seeking them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite broken families and reconcile between friends. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us and accept all of our good deeds, especially on this day of Eid. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants one and all a joyful and blessed Eid. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.